Project. So today let us try to implement the first experiment that is given in the syllabus. Let us first try to understand the question that is given there. The first question is, write a JavaScript to design a simple calculator to perform the following operations: sum, product, difference and quotient. So we are supposed to implement a JavaScript to implement addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. It's a very simple question. Now, what are the things that we need to use, or what are the languages that we'll be using here? So one is hypertext markup language, that is HTML, to display the elements, and to specify the computations we'll be using the JavaScript. Okay, so as we have discussed in earlier class, if you want to specify or if you want to create a HTML document, first thing you need to need is a editor. So I've opened the editor. I've created an empty HTML document. So I think you people recall what was discussed in the previous session, the structure of HTML file. So we need to begin with doctype HTML followed by the head tag, okay, the HTML tag, and within that you need to have the head and the body section. So within the head you can give a title to the web page that you are going to create it, which will appear as the tab name, and save this particular file within the C drive. In that C drive, whatever web server you have installed, and within that folder I have installed WAMP, and within the WAMP I have the www folder. You save it in that. Let me save it once again just to demonstrate that. So file, so save as, so C drive, within that we have the WAMP folder. Within the WAMP we have this www. You are supposed to save the file in that folder. Okay, you need to save the file in that folder. I have already saved it. Now you have created an empty HTML file, right? How to view its contents, how it appears? So before that you need to turn on the WAMP server. How do you do that? You just double click on the WAMP server. Okay, you just turn on, double click on the WAMP server. Here you will get the WAMP server symbol. If it is, let me just turn it off just for the demonstration purpose. So by default it will be off, it will be stopped. If you want to start the WAMP server, just click on it and click on start all services. You can identify that the WAMP server is started by looking at the color of this WAMP server. It changes from red to orange to green. When it is green, that indicates the WAMP server is running. So what you do now is go to your browser. Let us use the localhost. So localhost, you just type localhost slash the name of the file. Name of our file was experiment1.html. I click on enter. You can see there's nothing on this web page because we have not specified any elements within the body section. Only thing that we have specified is a title that is appearing over here. Right? This was a title that we have given. So every time you make changes to HTML file in the editor, save it, and you need to reload the page. Let us try to observe that. Okay, so we have the HTML element and the body. Now let us try to identify what can we have within the body section. Okay, so as we have just discussed earlier, we need to accept two inputs from the user and display one output. The inputs are the operands and the output is the result. So to accept the input, let us try to have two input fields. Okay, to have input fields, name of the tag is input type equals to text, right? Input type equal to text. Let us close this. So we will be accepting two inputs, right? So I've added two input types, places where we can enter the input, and we have saved the file. Just reload this page. As you can see, you got two input fields where you can enter some values, right? So we have just added two input fields, but just by displaying these two empty fields doesn't make any sense. the user, a layman, will never understand what is he supposed to do, right? So it's better if you properly organize these elements. So my recommendation is to put all these elements in a table, although there can be any other way in which you can specify that, or you can also specify the labels for that, text boxes, and you can specify what should be entered within those text boxes. Let us try that. Okay students, now let us try to design the web page first before specifying the JavaScript or before specifying how the computation should be performed. Let us first try to define or design the web page. So let us try to arrange all these elements in a better way. So what I would suggest or what I would follow is I would put all these elements in a table so that it's neatly arranged in rows and columns, although you can follow any other method, but make sure that the elements are displayed in a proper manner, in a proper structured ordered manner, so there shouldn't be any ambiguity in understanding the contents of the web page. So what I'll do is I'll remove these things. So I'm going to create a table tag. Within the table, let me just add 4 rows. So you know the element or the tag name to add the row is tr, so open tr and close tr. For every row we need to have a set of opening and closing tr tags. So let us create 4 rows, so 4 open and close tr tags, although you can add a bit of indentation so that the readability becomes better. Okay, so I have created opening and closing tag, and within that I have the 4 opening and closing table tags, the tr table row tags. Now in the first row, let us try to have a heading. So to have a heading, again we have discussed, we have a tag called as th. So th, open th, close th, let's give a heading, say simple calculator. So this adds a heading. I'll save this. So if you want to view the output, I'll just save it. Now try to reload the page in the browser and identify how it looks. So I'll just reload the page. So it just displays simple calculator. So no table borders will be displayed. For that, we need to add some styles, which we'll do later. Let us try to add the other elements, other rows, and try to view the output. Let us go back to the editor. In the second row, let us have 4 columns. Okay, let us assume we'll have 4 columns. For specifying every columns or the value in the columns, you need to use that td tag, open close td, open tag td and close the tag td. If you're having 4 columns in a row, again you need to have a 4 pairs of this open and close td. Again, let me just give a bit of indentation so that readability is better. Okay, now in the first td, let us specify the label for the input tag. Although there are other ways to do that, let us just initially let us just use this way. So I'm going to specify, or I'm going to guide the user to enter value 1 in the subsequent text box. So enter value 1 or enter operand 1. Okay, let me rename it as enter operand 1. So next field is it should accept the input from the user. For that, as we have discussed earlier, the tag we'll be using is input tag type equals to text. Okay, this will accept one, or this provides the user to enter one value. Similarly, the next column will be specifying the user to enter operand 2. That also should be a text field. That also should be input area where the user can enter a text. Let us save this. Let us try to reload the page. As you can see, enter operand 1, the user can enter some operand here. Enter operand 2, the user can operate some other operand here. It can enter some other operand. Okay. Now what else is required? Just look at the question once again. So we are supposed to perform these 4 operations. What are those operations? Sum, product, difference and quotient. For that, what we can do is, for each of these operations we can define one button. Let us do that in the next row. How How do we create a button in HTML? Let us see how do we do that. So first tag for every column we need to use that td, and within this td let us nest the input. But here instead of type equal to text, since we need to define a button, so input type equals to button, input type equals to button, close the input tag. And also what should be displayed as a name for that button, what text should be displayed on the button, that is specified using the attribute value equals to, let us first define a button as add. Okay, let us save it. Let us try to identify how the output looks like. So I reload the page. As you can see, one button is created and the name or the text that is displayed on the button is add. So we need to add three more buttons, one for subtract, divide and multiply. So let us do the same thing. So that was the first row. Similarly, I mean the first column in the second row, the third row. So one more button for subtract. Let me just give the minus symbol here. Let us just rename it with the plus symbol. So we need two more operations. One is multiply and one more is divide. So we have created four different buttons with four different symbols. Each symbol represents one operation, that is addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. Let me just save this HTML file and let me just reload it. As you can see here, we have created four different buttons with four arithmetic symbols over there. Instead of this arithmetic symbol, you can also specify the text. Okay, let us do that. And also what you can observe here is that even if you click on these buttons, nothing is happening because we have not defined anything. Okay, we have not defined the onClick attribute of these buttons. Let us go back to our editor and let us try to rename this button. Instead of plus addition plus symbol, let us describe it as add. Okay, second operation, or let us retain it as plus itself. Fine. Now when the button is clicked, what should happen? That is defined using an attribute called as onClick. Okay, so when this button is clicked, which JavaScript method should be called? That is defined using the attribute called as onClick. For the time being, let us just define this, let us just keep it as blank, because we'll later decide what JavaScript function to call. Okay, before that let us add an ID to each of these buttons. An ID uniquely identifies a button out of, if there are many buttons, if you want to uniquely identify a button, that is identified using its ID. Okay, first ID is add. You cannot give any name there, but make sure the names are meaningful. So second ID is for subtraction. Let me give it as sub subtract. Third ID is to multiply. So let me give it as product, or let me give it as multiplication, MUL. And the next ID is for the divide. So ID equals to, I'm going to give symbol or the ID name as div for division. So here we have created four different buttons. Every button is having a particular name that is given by the value. Okay, and the onClick specifies the JavaScript function name that should be called when the button is clicked. It's like a event handler. Okay, I'll save it over here. So let me just show you the output again. Till now, whatever we have designed. So first, this is basically a table. First row, we have a heading, simple calculator. Second row, first column is a text. Okay, second row, second column, we have a text box or a text field where the user can enter the text. Third is again the plain text, which is not editable. And the fourth one is the field where the user can enter the text. It's an input type equal to text field. The third row of your table, you have one button in every column. First column, you have the plus button. Second column, minus. Third one is multiplication symbol. And fourth one is the division symbol. Each one of these are buttons, right? So add, subtract, multiply, and divide. Let us try to provide details or elaborate the button names so that it's better understood. So addition. Okay. So here subtraction. Let us give it as add. Subtract. Here let us give it as multiply or product multiply. Let us give it as product. Okay, and the last one is quotient. Divide. Okay, you can also name it as sum, difference, product and subscription and quotient. Let us keep it like this. You can give the label of your choice or the button name of your choice. I'll save it. Let us reload it. As you can see, add, subtract, product and divide. Instead of product, let us just change it to sum, difference. Makes better sense. Instead of addition, let me give it as sum, difference, product and quotient. Okay, so I save it. Let us try to view the output. Right, sum, difference, product and quotient. So we have reached the third row. Now what should be displayed in the last row there? In the last row, let us try to display the result, a label and a field where the computer result will be displayed, and then one more button to clear all the input fields. How can we do that? Let us check it now. So in the fourth row of your table, what we do is initially we enter a normal text, say the result. We close the TD tag. In the next TD tag, what we do is we need to specify one more field. What we can do is we can specify the input type equal to text itself. Let us do that. There may be other options also. So right now I'll be using this input type equals to text. Right. And in the next column, let us try to have one more button to clear all the input fields, just like what we have in the calculators. So how do we create a button? Using the tag input type equals to button, input type equals to button value equal to, since we want this button to clear all the field, you can just name it as clear all. And let us give the some ID to it. ID equals to, it can be any ID name. So let me give it as CLS. On click, what should happen? Let us just keep it blank for the time being. On click equals to, let us later decide what should be the JavaScript function name that should be specified within this opening and closing double quotes. So I save it. Let us try to view our output. So I open the browser, again reload the page. As you can see, the last row of the table has also been displayed there. First column result, second column is a field where the result will be displayed. Third column is a button. Fourth column, we don't have anything. Now, if you look at this, again, it doesn't look like a table. Let us first try to make it appear like a table. How can we do that? Now, to do that, we need to add a bunch of styles. Okay. So before that, let us make sure, let us try to adjust the spanning of these elements. As you can see, out of these four columns, this simple calculated heading, it's displayed only in only one column. Let us try to merge all these columns for the first row by using this column span attribute of the th tag. Similarly, this button, instead of keeping it in only the third column, let us try to merge the third and fourth column and then display this, again using the column span. So here you can observe there are four columns, so we need to span this element across all these four columns. Let us try to do that. So simple calculator, it was here. let us try to use the attribute called span, which is used to span an element, a header, across all the four columns. Since we have four columns here, just set it to 4. I save it. Again, I reload the page. As you can see, now it is appearing in a much better way, where the header is spanned across all the four columns. Let us try to apply the same thing for this clear all button as well. So, but remember here, how many columns we need to span here? It is the third and the fourth column, right? So we better set the call span value to 2. Let's do that now. So we have this button here. So we need to use the call span attribute for the td tag. So call column span equals to 2 and save it. Once we have saved it, just reload the
table with 4 rows and 4 columns,
right? So we have the first column with a table name which spans across all the 4 columns, the first row. Second row, we have 4 columns with the some text and the input fields to enter the 2 operands. Third row that we have created, it basically displays 4 buttons, 1 button in each column of the table with proper button names. And the last row we have is specifies 3 things, 3 elements. So one is a text that specifies the result, one more is the area where the result will be displayed, and then you have created one more button called as clear all, which clears the input fields. Now what to do next? Now let us try to make this table appear in a little better way. Let us try to add some styling elements to this particular table, shall we? To add style to a table, we need to use a style tag. The name of the tag itself is style, and remember we are specifying it in the head section of your HTML document and not in the body. For style, open style tag, close the style tag. This is how you specify an internal CSS, right? This is an example for internal CSS. Earlier in one of the demonstrations, we have used styling over here along with the tag. That's called as inline CSS. We'll be using internal CSS here. So within the style tag, let us try to add the style by using the attribute and its values. So for which element we need to add style here? So we'll be adding the style to the element table as well as td and tr. I'm sorry, td and th. So the syntax is like this: specify the name of the table, name of the elements. If there are multiple elements, if you want to apply the same style, separate those element names by commas. When I mean by element names, it is I'm referring to the tag names itself. Element name and tag name is one and the same thing. So you specify the tag names for which you want to apply the styles, then open and close a brace. Now within this opening and closing brace, you need to specify which style attributes you are going to specify and what value are you going to set to it. The syntax is attribute value colon, I mean attribute name colon value followed by a semicolon. Now let us say I want to set the attribute border to 2 pixel and a solid border. So what do I need to do is, the name of the attribute here is border colon, what should the value I need to set it to? The value is 2 pixel and solid, followed by a semicolon. The syntax is attribute name, in this case it is border, followed by a colon, then followed by the value 2 pixel and solid. So that is one attribute that I have set here. So let me save this HTML file and let us try to observe the output by reloading this page. So do you observe the change here? Each and every element is now demarcated. It is having a boundary because of the style that we have applied. You can just understand how the styling improve the appearance of your web page. Earlier it was very plain, it was very bland. Now it looks a little better, right? Let us try to add some more styling details here. So apart from the border, let us also try to align the text at the center. Now if you can just observe here, all the text is aligned to the left, right? Let us try to align all these things to the center by again adding one more style attribute, that is text align. Text hyphen align colon, the value is center followed by a semicolon. This is the second style attribute that we have set, align all the text to the center. I'll save it and I reload the page. Okay, I'm sorry. So I save it and I reload the page. Do you observe all these elements are now appearing at the center? Earlier it was appearing to the left. This looks little better compared to the previous one. Let's see what other styles we can do here. So we can change the background color of the table as well. Let us do that. Let us set the background color of the table. So for that we have attribute called as background color colon. You can set it to any color of your choice. So that color will be applied to all the elements that you have mentioned here as a background color. So let me select a color called as sky blue. You can select any color of your choice, but make sure that the text within the table is clearly visible. I've set the color here to now sky blue as a background color for these three elements, table, TD and TH. I save it. Let's try to observe how it looks. Reload the page. As you can see, the background color is changed to sky blue color. This appears a little better compared to the previous background color. The table is highlighted now. You can select any color of your choice and you can view the output on the browser. So let us try to align the table at the center of the web page. For that, let us set the margin attribute to auto. Okay, margin colon, the value that I'm going to set is auto. So I've set the margin attribute to auto. Okay, let me set it to auto and let us just save this file and let us try to view the output. Let us just reload this web page. As you can see, now the entire table is present at the center of your exactly halfway from the left and the right boundaries of your browser, I mean the web page. So this looks much better. Similarly, you can add styling to the different text element that is visible there and so on. I think this styling is sufficient since this is the first program. Anyhow, as you learn more and more about cascading style sheets, you can apply different styles. You can also use the same style as an external file and you can make use of external style sheets. So whatever styling details that you have defined here, you can save it as a file with extension .css. Later you can link it to this HTML file also, thereby making use of external CSS. So all those things you can discuss it later. For the time being, just remember, for the table element we have applied four style attributes. The border we have set it to 2 pixel. text align attribute we have set it to the value center. Background color attribute we have set it to the value sky blue, which is the background color of the table, and margin we have set it to auto, right? So this is how the design of the page is done. Now I think that should do it. This is the basic design. You have the header and the first row, which spans across 4 columns. Second row, text followed by input type equal to the text box, the text field where you can enter the input the values. Third row specifies 4 different buttons on which you can click, and the fourth row is the result, where the result will be displayed here and you have a clear button. First it is design of the web page, then we need to define the logic behind it. So whenever you are designing some web page, first ask the question, what are the things you are going to display, how you are going to display, where you are going to display. All these things are defined using your HTML. Then how should these values or data should be displayed or processed in your web page, or what computation should be done, that is defined using scripting languages such as JavaScript. Okay, now let us try to add a bit more detail to whatever elements we have specified there in a basic design. So what we can do is, in the input fields which accepts the input, let us try to give the IDs to those input fields as well. Okay, for the input field that accepts the first operand, let us give the ID as, you can give any ID, let me give it as value 1, or you can also give it as operand 1 also. I've given the value as ID as value 1, that is first input value. And what we can do is, we can specify some default value to be displayed there. Instead of just displaying blank input fields, what we can do is, we can just display some default values. So what I'll do is, I'll just assign value equals to 0. So this 0 will be displayed over there. Okay, similarly, let me just add the same thing to the next input field as well. So ID equals to, let me give the ID name to this second input field as value 2, and the default value which is specified using value attribute, let me set it to 0 as well. So first input field, it is identified with the ID value 1. Second input field, it is identified with the value ID equals to value 2. And for both these input fields, the default value is set to 0. Let us check how this appears. Okay, now let us try to specify the ID to the input type equal text, the third text field that we have there. So let us give some ID. Let me give the ID as answer. You can give any other ID as well, but make sure you remember this ID name. So I'm going to give the ID as answer. So apart from ID, what can we specify? We can also specify the value. So what value to specify here? You can keep it as blank. Okay, just the two quotes, opening double quote and closing double quotes, two double quotes that specifies blank value space. So we have specified the type, ID and answer. Let us save this. Okay, what else is required? See, if you just observe your web page, this field, this third input type equal to text, that input field, that is editable. You can insert some values. That shouldn't be possible. Why shouldn't be possible? This field should be used only to display the result after computation, after performing one of these operations. Let us try to resolve that issue. So what we can do is, we can make this input field disabled just by using the word disabled within that element. Let us see how to do that. Let us go to the same input element here and let us just try to enter disabled. This will disable that input field. Okay, disabled. Let's save this. I've saved this file and now let us reload it to apply the changes. As you can see, I cannot enter anything. This field is now disabled. So we need to think these minute user controls or minute things we need to remember to make our web page more user friendly. So now the user, even if he mistakenly tries to enter something here, he won't be able to do because it will be disabled. So we'll be able to only enter the two operands, value 1 and value 2, through these two input fields. Okay, so we have done with the basic design here. So what we have done is, now we have added default values to these two text fields and we have disabled the third input text field. Okay, now that we have done with the design of the web page, what is left out is specifying the logic. Okay, now for specifying the logic, we need to use some scripting. In this example, since they have asked us to use JavaScript, we will be using JavaScript to define the logic. Okay, now to define or to embed the JavaScript within your HTML, you will need to use a tag called as script. The name of the tag is script, and type equals to text slash JavaScript. So this specifies you are including JavaScript in this HTML, text slash JavaScript. Okay, and close the tag, and whatever JavaScript statements you are going to write, that should be nested within this opening and closing script tag. And I mean scripting, nesting, it means putting it within another tag. Okay, so remember, if you want to specify a JavaScript statements within HTML file, you need to put it within the script tag. So if you're referring some external JavaScript, then you need to specify one more attribute called as src, and you can define the JavaScript statements in that file. Anyhow, we'll look into that later. For the time being, let us just use the JavaScript within the script tag of the same HTML. Now, within this particular script tag, what we need to define is what happens when we click on the buttons, right? We need to define the functionalities, what happens when the buttons are clicked. So let us try to define some function to handle the onClick event. Okay, so the syntax for defining a function in JavaScript is keyword function space function name. You can use any function name. Let me use the function name called as compute or calculate, whatever it is. Let me use it as calculate, calc, that is the name of the function, and some parameter if it is passed, followed by the function body. Okay, this is the syntax for defining a JavaScript function. Okay, now what can be the parameter that can be passed to a function? If you remember, we had four buttons and every button had an ID. Okay, so we had add button, we had subtract button, divide and multiplication buttons. So we can pass the IDs of those buttons to identify which button was clicked. So let us specify the parameter here as clicked ID or ID, just for representing which button was clicked. What is the ID of the button that was clicked? Okay. So if I click on add button, if I click on some button, add will be passed as a parameter to this calculator function, the calculation function. Similarly, if I click on minus or the difference, SUB will be passed as a ID here. Okay. So that is of the syntax for defining the function. So how many functions do we need here? So let us have two functions. One function is to perform these computations, these four operations, arithmetic operations. And let us try to define one more function to handle the onClick event of clear. For clearing the input fields, let us try to define one more function. Again, this the keyword function, space, the name of the function. Here it doesn't need any parameters. Let us just keep define an empty function, right? So we have defined two functions. We have not defined it. We have just named two functions. One is for calculating the sum, difference, product and quotient, and one more is to clear the input fields. Right. Now let's try to add two variables, value 1 and value 2. So in JavaScript, variables are specified using the keywords var. Now how should these values, value 1 and value 2 should be, or variables value 1 and value 2 should be initialized? For that we'll be using the JavaScript DOM, the document object module. So this DOM is used, can be used to modify the HTML elements, the attributes, their styles and so on. Now to fetch the value from a given element, so we'll be using the DOM document dot get element by ID. Get element by ID. Observe the camel casing here. Document dot get, G is lowercase, every other word begins with uppercase, element by ID. Here you need to specify which ID you will be used to fetch the value from. What is the ID of the element from which you are going to get the element from? Now here we need to get the element from the, we need to get the value from the input element whose value is value 1. So let us enter value 1 here. Value 1. Okay. So from this element whose ID is value 1, what are we going to fetch? We are going to fetch its value. Okay. So document.getElementById value 1 dot value. What this indicates is variable value 1 will fetch, or variable val 1 will fetch the value from the input element whose ID is value 1. So document.getElementById, what is the ID that we are referring here? It is value 1 and its value. Similarly, let us copy and paste the same statement for element or the variable v2, val 2. So document.getElementById, so what is the second operand? It is given by the element input whose ID is value 2. That is the only change here. So variable val 1 is initialized with the value that is present in input element whose ID is value 1. Similarly, second operand is fetched from this input element whose ID is value 2. That is what it indicates. This is the JavaScript DOM, which is used to access, modify, change the attribute styles or even the elements themselves in HTML. The next step is to check whether the string entered by the user is a number or not. So for that, we can use one more JavaScript function called as isNaN, which stands for is not a number. The name of the function is isNaN, and it accepts a variable as a parameter. It accepts a value as a parameter. In our case, we need to check whether our variables val1 and val2 contains numbers or not. So what we can do is, we can use a simple if statement. If is NaN value 1 or val1, or logical, or is NaN value 2. So if either of these variables are, is not a number, In that case, we need to display a message, right? It checks if any of these val1 or val2 variable is contains a value that is not a number. In that case, something should be done. What should be done? It should alert the user saying that enter proper number. Now, how do we alert the user in HTML to display or enter a proper number? For that, we have the alert function to display the alert box. Okay, so we'll be using alert and some string to notify to the user. So let us display some message. Please enter numbers only. Okay, so this will be displayed as an alert box. So let us just save it. Okay, so if you want to check this, we need to make sure this function calc is called when one of the buttons are clicked, right? So how do we ensure that? Make sure you remember the function name calc. That should be specified and that should be set as a event handler for the functions. So let us just paste it over here, calc, and if you just look at its header, the function header here, it also accepts a parameter. So what parameter to pass here? It should be the id of this particular element. To specify that, you just write this.id. Okay, so what this indicates is when the button sum is clicked, the id add, that is this.id, will be passed to the function calc. So let us try to add the same to all the other buttons as well. Okay, so whenever one of these buttons is clicked, it calls the calc function, passing its id as a parameter to it. Right, let us just save the function, save the file, and let's try to reload it and observe the output. So I reload the page. So by default it is zero. I click on sum, nothing happens. Let me just change the text to some string. Okay, I click on one of these buttons and you get an alert message there. So this is of your refining your user interaction. You need to check as many possible cases or different scenarios as possible. You need to check all the possible cases. So this is one case where the user may actually accidentally enter some other values other than the numbers. So it should be checked properly and suitable messages should be displayed. Similarly, I enter something here, some string here other than the numbers. Whereas here I may enter some number. I click on one of the buttons. Again, it displays a alert box. Now we have checked the basic condition. We are passing the string that is entered by the user, converting it into float and storing in variables val1 and val2, and after that we have checked these variables whether they contain a number or not. If they contain a number, we should perform the computation. If not, we should display an alert message. So let us do the reverse of that here. So if it is not a number, display an alert message. If it is a number, we need to perform the computation. So we can use the else if statements, just like what we use in our C programming language. So else if, that means if it is a number, if both the variables contain a number. Now what else are we supposed to check? See, observe here, we have passed the ID of the button that was clicked. Let us assume I had clicked on some button. I mean the add button, addition button, some button. So here what should happen is if the clicked ID, okay, the name of the variable here, I mean the parameter that is passed, if it contains the value add. What is this add now? Add is the ID of the button which performs addition. Okay, if this button was clicked, that is identified by this statement. If clicked ID, which is passed to this particular function as a parameter, if it is add, then what are we supposed to do? Find the sum of these two variables, value1 and value2, or val1 and val2, store it in one more variable and display it in the third field here. Display it in this field whose ID is answer. Again, we'll be using the DOM of JavaScript by using the statement document dot get element by ID. Observe the casing there, document.getElementById, whose ID is answer. So document.getElementById answer, its value equals to, what should be the value if add is clicked? The values of variables val1 and val2 should be added. So val1 plus val2, right? So if the add button is clicked or if sum is clicked, we should find the sum of two variables, val1 and val2, and its result value should be set as the value of the input element whose ID is answer. So we are done with one case, that is handle clicking on the sum or the addition button. Similarly, we need to handle three more cases. What are those? Subtraction, multiplication and division. What you can do is you can replace, copy the same statements. For addition, we have already handled that case. For subtraction, what is the ID? The ID is SUB. If the button whose ID is SUB is clicked, then the same statement, document.getElementById answer.value equals to, instead of addition, we are going to perform the subtraction. Similarly, multiplication and division also. So else if clicked ID is, what is the ID for multiplication? We have the ID as MUL. MUL. If the ID is MUL, that if you have clicked on the button which performs multiplication, document.getElementById answer.value equal to multiply or write assign the product of val1 and val2. And the last case, what is the last case? Else if clicked ID is the last ID here, division, div. Is div, we are supposed to find the quotient here. So value 1 divided by value 2, that will be assigned as a value to the element whose ID is answer. Let us just save this file. Okay, now that we have checked whether the buttons are working properly, the addition, subtraction, multiplication and division, so we checked these functionalities of the buttons are working, addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. So what we can do is, let us also check the condition for the division operation where the denominator is equal to 0. So again, let us use the if condition within the else if. So if, we need to check if the value of the second operand, that is the variable val2, if it is equal to 0. If it is so, we need to notify the user. So we can use the alert function, alert. So what can be the message? Can be anything. So say, please enter non-zero denominator or any other message, so that the user will know that he is not supposed to enter value as zero for the denominator. Okay, so after this, what you can do is you can also include a function. So location dot reload, this will reload the page. It's not mandatory, you can also try, because the page reloads once after clicking on OK, the location reloads. Okay, I mean the page refreshes. Else, our usual part. So find the quotient of value 1 variable divided by value 2 and store it in the value of the element, the input element whose ID is answer. So let us just copy and paste the same statement here. Else, document.getElementById whose ID is answer, the element is input element, and assign its value as the quotient of val1 divided by val2. Let me just save this file. I have saved it, and now let me just reload the page here. So I have reloaded it. As you can see, by default both the operands are zero. I click on quotient, so you'll get this message, please enter non-zero denominator. Let us just change the message. Let's go back, non-zero denominator. Okay, that should do it. So I'm going to save the file. Again, reload it, right, 0 by 0, please enter non-zero denominator. So by looking at this, the user can make out that they're supposed to enter non-zero denominator. I click on OK and the page refreshes. Let's try it once again, say 10 divided by 0, quotient, please enter non-zero denominator. I click on OK and the page reloads. As you can see, 10 is now replaced with 0, that is the default. Now that the basic operations are completed, let us check if any other part is left out. As you can see, so we have defined this calculation function which acts as a event handler for these buttons. So whenever these buttons are clicked, this function will be invoked and the ID of those input elements will be passed. Okay, and that value will be used, the ID will be used here to specify which operation that needs to be performed, whether it is addition, subtraction, multiplication or division. Now what is left out here is we need to define the function CLS. Now what should this function CLS do? It should actually clear all the fields in that particular web page. It should clear all the fields. So before defining it, let us try to invoke it from here. So whenever the button clear all is clicked, this function CLS should be called. So we can specify it like this. So on click, how do we do that? On click, just specify the function name. We don't have to pass any arguments, just the function. That's it. So this CLS will be the event handler, or when the button clear all is clicked, this function, JavaScript function CLS, will be called. Now let us try to define the CLS function. If we have observed the normal calculators, if you click on that clear buttons or the C button, the values will be set to zero. All the values or the operand values will be set to zero. That is what we are going to do here, a very simple instruction. So which are the input fields here? Input fields are the fields with the IDs value 1 and value 2. So for both these input fields, we need to reset the value to 0, and we need to reset the answer field to also blank, right? The three input fields should be set to different values. Value 1 and value 2, these two input fields should be set to 0, and the value of the input field whose ID is CLS should be set to blank. So how do we do that using DOM? So value 1 dot value equals to 0. So 0 will be displayed there. Similarly, value 2 dot value will also be set to 0, and answer dot value. So what should that result field should be set to? It should be set to blank. Nothing should be displayed there. Let us just save it and try to view the changes in the web page. Let me just reload this web page. Web page is reload. Let us just add the two numbers, 10 and say 25. 10 and 25. I click on sum. So 10 plus 25 equals to 35. The answer is displayed. Now let us check if the clear all button works. I click on clear all and it is working. So both these fields will be set to 0 and this will be displaying nothing. As you can see, this field is disabled. Right? So this is this is how the JavaScript is used to embed logic into your web page. HTML displays all these elements. All these elements, whatever things are visible on your web page, that is defined using HTML. So specifying the operations for these elements, that or the logic for these buttons or the computation, that is defined using the JavaScript. So with this experiment one is complete. So let me just briefly recall what are the things we have done. Initially, define the web page, define the elements of the web page, identify what are the things that needs to be displayed on the web page, how it should be displayed, that is your styling details, and where it should be displayed, position on the web page, whether it should be in a table, whether it should be in a form, and so on. In this example, I have used table, although you are free to use any of the other ways of displaying these elements. So we have put all these elements within a table. So table tag, within that we have tr tag, which is used for individual rows. So we had four rows, so four sets of tr and tr opening and closing tags. So first row we had a heading, so th tag we have used. The other rows we just had the table data or td tags. So we have two inputs fields in the second row. We have four buttons, input type equal to button, on the third row of the table. And in the fourth row we have some text, one input field which is disabled. Please note this. This input field is disabled because this field should not accept any value from the user. And also the last column in the last row, it is having a button called as clear all, which clears all the fields. So that is the HTML part. Now we have also defined the functions for handling the event when these buttons are clicked, right? For all these buttons, we have a common function called as CLC, a JavaScript function, which accepts the ID of the element as the parameter. So we have defined that function here. So CALC, whatever value, whatever button that was clicked, its ID will be passed here. So we are going to retrieve the value from the elements whose IDs is value 1 and value 2, and we are going to store it in variables value val 1 and val 2 after passing it to float. That is why we have used this function parse float. And this is a document object model in Java, JavaScript, document.getElementById, whatever ID that you want to specify, dot its value. Then we are going to check if the variables val1 and val2 contain numbers or not. If it doesn't contain numbers or if it is not a number, we display suitable message. Else, we check which is the button that is clicked. If it is add button that was clicked, what we do is we add the two variables val1 plus val2, and we assign the sum as a value to the input field whose ID is answer. Same thing we do for subtraction, which just change the symbol. Same thing holds true for the multiplication as well, where we replace it with the multiplication symbol. Whereas in case of division operator or division operation, what we do is we just check if the denominator is 0 using this if condition. If the denominator is equal to 0, display proper message to the user, as I say, and after that just reload that page. Okay, else, so reload of that page is done using the function location.reload. It refreshes the page. Else, same thing, find the quotient of val1 divided by val2 and store the quotient as the value of the field whose ID is answer. As you can see, we have also defined the style for the some of the elements, that is table td, th and input. So this is the way of specifying internal CSS within the style tag. And we have specified this style within the head section. Also the script element or the script tag, that is also defined within the head section. Our JavaScript is embedded within this script tag. We specify that we are using JavaScript by using this type attribute. Script type equals to text slash JavaScript. Now in the styling for the table, the TD and the TH tag, we have specified the attributes border and the value for that attributes. So the syntax was attribute colon values. So first attribute that we have set is border. We have set it to 2 pixel and solid. Second attribute is alignment of the text. So text align, text hyphen align, colon center. Center is the value. Similarly, background color for the table, colon, what color should be displayed. I have set it as sky blue. And all this styling, you can do it as per your convenience, as per your choice. And also margin, we have set it to auto. And then for the second element input, we have aligned it to center. So this is your experiment one. So every time you make any changes to your HTML file, save it. To observe the changes, just reload that particular page. Right? So this is your experiment one, a simple calculator which accepts two inputs from the user and performs either addition, subtraction, multiplication or division and displays the results.